We're back with our analysts following the breaking news out of a new court filing by Robert Mueller. There's certainly a lot of discussion in the Russia investigation this hour, including the allegations against Roger Stone, the longtime Trump advisor, now under indictment, is facing another court hearing here in Washington on Friday. Our political correspondent, Sarah Murray, is back with us. Sarah, we've been hearing some powerful accusations from Stone associate Jerome Corsi. What's the latest?
That's right. Jerome Corsi insists that on the day this infamous Access Hollywood tape was released during the 2016 campaign, that Roger Stone wanted help from WikiLeaks to blunt the impact. This coming as Stone tells President Trump he better watch out for what else Mueller has up his sleeve.
As Roger Stone fires off a warning shot to President Trump about the Russia investigation.
The president needs to wake up. This is a speeding bullet heading for his head, not me. I'm just a small collateral damage compared to him.
Conservative author and conspiracy theorist Jerome Corsi is doubling down on his claim that in the bleakest moment of Trump's presidential campaign, Stone turned to WikiLeaks for help.
It's my recollection that Roger mentioned that this Billy Bush was coming and he wanted to know if Assange could begin dropping emails.
In October 2016, just a month before Election Day, a tape became public showing Trump in 2005 bragging about sexual assault to former Access Hollywood host Billy Bush.
You know, I'm automatically attracted to beautiful. I just start kissing them. It's like a magnet. You just kiss. I don't even wait. And when you're a star, they let you do it. You can do anything.
Corsi claims before the tape was released publicly, Stone knew it was coming. He called Corsi with a request. Convince WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange to release Clinton campaign chairman John Podesta's hacked emails.
Come on, Billy, don't be shy.
Less than half an hour after the Access Hollywood tape was released, WikiLeaks dropped its first batch of Podesta emails, emails that WikiLeaks obtained from the Russians, according to U.S. intelligence. In an email at the time, Corsi suggested he should get credit for some of the WikiLeaks document dumps, but he denies he ever communicated with Assange.
I had, I believe, figured out that Assange had Podesta's emails, and I did tell this not only to Roger, but to others, and it turned out that I was right. Now, that was deduction on my part, as best I can remember. I was putting together the dots.
The Access Hollywood tape rocked the Trump campaign, as Chris Christie, the former New Jersey governor who advised Trump during the campaign, recalls in his new book.
The tape was hard to watch. It was harder to listen to. But we watched and listened to the Access Hollywood video all the way to the end. The words sounded crude and vulgar playing through the small speaker on Hope Hicks' laptop, even more so with Donald sitting there with us.
At the time, Stone wasn't a campaign staffer, but he has long served as a political advisor to Trump. He vehemently denies that he asked Corsi to reach out to Assange and has accused his former associate of spreading lies about him.
Jerry Corsi is clearly delusional.
Stone has pleaded not guilty to 7 charges of obstruction of justice, making false statements, and witness tampering. And even though Corsi said he shared the Access Hollywood saga with special counsel Robert Mueller's team and the grand jury, it wasn't referenced in Stone's indictment.
There was no other evidence of that in the public record that we know of. Absent that, it seems that Mueller is not going to rely on the word of Corsi all by itself as part of this indictment. It's just too dangerous for Mueller.
2 months ago, Mueller's team told Corsi they were prepared to indict him for lying to investigators, although not about the Access Hollywood story specifically. They offered Corsi a plea deal, which he rejected.
Now, so far, Jerome Corsi is not facing any charges from Mueller. As for Roger Stone, he's going to be back in court on Friday. And, of course, the big question is when he's in front of this judge who will oversee a trial, whether she decides to move forward with a gag order on the case.
All right, Sarah, I want you to stand by. Everybody stand by. Jeffrey Toobin, I need your analysis right now. If there was a direct effort to coordinate, to direct the WikiLeaks release of the John Podesta emails in order to help the Trump campaign, what would that mean?
Well, this is where you have to speak with a good deal of precision, because a lot depends on precisely what the interaction was with WikiLeaks. If people affiliated with the Trump campaign, if Roger Stone, Jerome Corsi, were simply trying to find out what had already been hacked and what was coming out, I don't think that's necessarily a crime. But if they were encouraging, if they were assisting, if they were aiding and abetting WikiLeaks in the criminal obtaining of hacked emails, that would be a crime. The facts matter, and I don't think, especially when you're dealing with the likes of Jerome Corsi and Roger Stone, who may have serious credibility problems, we don't know all the facts. That's why the prosecutors are relying so much on the texts and the emails, because they're a lot easier to believe than oral testimony.
It's a very important point, David Swerlick. How much weight can you really give to Jerome Corsi's words?
Well, I agree with Jeffrey. You can give some weight to Jerry Corsi's words, and if what he says is true, that's a bombshell. But I think what the special prosecutor's looking at and what everybody in the public should look at is those series of emails between the summer and fall of 2016 between Corsi and Roger Stone that have been reported out. I just want to point out one other thing happened on that day, October 7th, 2016. That was the day that the Obama administration publicly, formally charged Russia with the DNC hack. And that also got buried that day by the Access Hollywood story.
That's an important point as well. You know, Phil, you think the electronic devices, the other information that were seized by the FBI in the raids on Roger Stone's two homes, one in Florida, one in New York, a storage facility that he had, that could provide some significant evidence?
Yeah, but that's only half the story. It's not only the electronic devices. You're going to go to an internet service provider and get the data from them as well. That might, let me give you an intel term, hops. That might tell you whether somebody talked to somebody, talked to somebody, talked to WikiLeaks. You're talking three hops out. So you can get a sense of who talked to whom. The problem here is if they didn't write in email or in text, and instead just had a phone call, which wouldn't have been recorded, you're not going to know what they said. And as we're discussing here, I wouldn't believe any of these people. So you can find out who talked to whom, but I'm not sure you can find out what they said.
And Sarah, it's interesting. We don't know the identities of the Trump campaign officials who were in touch with Roger Stone directly and indirectly to talk about some of these sensitive matters. But I have no doubt that Mueller and his team, I'm sure they know.
I'm sure they do know, and I'm sure that there is a reason that they did not name these people by name. I mean, or at least drop the breadcrumbs for us to figure it out. Some of them we did. Steve Bannon, for instance, was one of them. But for some of these other people, they've held back a little bit, in part because, you know, they don't want to rely on these witnesses unless there is corroborating evidence, unless they have documents, unless they have emails, text messages, recordings of a lot of these conversations. I think the special counsel has been really hesitant to put anything out there unless they have copious evidence to back it up. And so in the case of Roger Stone, that still leaves us wondering who were all these other administration officials that he was in contact with.
If you listen, Rebecca, to White House officials, they say that Roger Stone was in charge with conspiracy or collusion. End of story.
Well, unfortunately for them, it's not the end of the story. Well, far from it. This story is continuing. The investigation is ongoing. It's not out of the realm of possibility that Roger Stone could be charged with other crimes down the line. This is possibly just the first tranche of charges that he could be receiving. And by the way, there's also another judge and jury to consider in all of this, and that's the public. That's the American people, because ultimately, from a political perspective, they will be bringing down a judgment on the president in 2020, regardless of what Mueller concludes. And so all of this information is relevant for that as well.
You know, Jeffrey, there's still a lot of sense out there. Despite all the suggestions, maybe Mueller's getting closer and closer to wrapping it up and releasing his report, that there potentially could be more indictments down the road.
We've been surprised every time every time Mueller has come out with an indictment. You know, we have all tried, those of us who have, you know, covered this, to know what was coming, and we've never figured it out. So, you know, the one actual fact that came out recently was Matt Whitaker, the acting attorney general, saying he's been briefed on the investigation and he believed it's coming to an end. But that's still pretty imprecise. Is that a couple of weeks? Is that 6 months? I don't know. So I am going to give you a ringing I don't know about when and whether this investigation is coming to an end.
You'll let us know for sure. I'm sure you'll know very quickly. You know, it's interesting. Whitaker, the acting attorney general, you know, Sarah, when he says he's been fully briefed on the Mueller investigation, we don't know who briefed them. Was it Mueller himself? Was it somebody on Mueller's team? Was it the Deputy Attorney General, Rod Rosenstein? Those are significant developments.
Yeah, those are significant developments. And I also think, you know, the idea that the investigation is wrapping up, that could mean a lot of different things. That could mean that the investigative steps are wrapping up, that there are no more big indictments coming down, but they're still going to be working on this report. They still have other court action to finish up. Or it could mean that this is really just wrapping up. Roger Stone is the end of it. They're near the end of the report. You know, I don't think that we're going to get more details on that from Matt Whitaker, because I think he maybe has realized he gave us more details than he was supposed to the first time around. But we'll see.
He was sweating when he was talking, too. What do you anticipate?
Look, I think we're missing missing the critical piece. The president tweets a lot about stuff relating to money. Money is a Southern District of New York, I think, and Cohen, along with the Trump family accountant.
Michael Cohen.
Michael Cohen. So we keep talking about Mueller, and even if Mueller closes, my point is we should be looking in New York to say, are there going to be charges related to family money? That's something I think that could set the president off maybe even more than some of the Russia stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think you're right, because they're looking at, go ahead.
But it's also worth remembering that, you know, the Senate, the House Intelligence Committee, as well as the House Oversight Committee and Financial Affairs Committee are going to be looking at the Trump family finances. Mm-hmm. So that will continue regardless of what happens with Mueller. So there are a lot of moving parts out there, and we don't have all the answers.
And the Democratic majority in the House of Representatives, they're going to try to get Donald Trump's tax returns as well.